press the bell icon on the YouTube app and never miss another update.
Namaste children, in this class we'll discuss about animal kingdom. So Vikas, very good morning. So any need is there to classify organisms? Can anyone tell me why we have to classify organisms? Ananya, good morning. Kirtana, good morning. Nisha, good morning. So there is need is there to classify organisms for study purpose. So we know that in biological classification, organisms are classified into different kingdoms. So we are following R.H. Whittaker classification. So he classified organisms into five kingdoms: Kingdom Monera, Kingdom Protista, Kingdom Mycota, Kingdom Plantae, and Kingdom Animalia. In this class, we'll discuss Kingdom Animalia. So animals are, Akash, good morning. So animals are multicellular organisms. They are motile. Motile means they can move from one place to another place and depend on organic matter or organisms, and they have very well developed sense organs and neural system. So systematics, S. Sumo, studying all organisms is almost impossible. So if we classify, it will easy for study purpose, S. Okay, if we classify them, that helps in study about different types of organisms. So phylo systematic study tells that this animal kingdom is phylogenetic in nature. Phylogenetic, monophyletic in nature. It is monophyletic in nature, means all animals have evolved from a single ancestors, probably colonial flagellated protists. So now we'll discuss some salient features of animal kingdom or metazoa. So in salient features, so there are eukaryotic means animal cells are eukaryotic in nature, without cell wall, without plastids, without any photosynthetic pigments, and they are multicellular. So here, as they are multicellular, cells group. Saundarya, good morning. So cells group together to form tissues, then organ system, and an organism. So they are multicellular and heterotrophic in nature. Heterotrophic, you know that. Anyone can tell me the difference between autotrophs and heterotrophs? Darshan, good morning. Yes, anyone can tell me the difference between autotrophs and heterotrophs? Already you know about that in your lower classes. So we know that autotrophs can synthesize their food, whereas heterotrophs can't do that. So these organisms, as Sarika, autotrophs can make their own food. Abdul, they can prepare their own food. Yes, autotrophs can prepare their own food like plants, because good. Whereas animals, they cannot prepare their own food and they dependent on autotrophs. So here they are heterotrophic in nature, means they cannot prepare their food. They depend on other organisms, that is, they depend on autotrophs. Then locomotion, they exhibit locomotion. They can move from one place to another place. Asynchrona, heterotrophs depend on the other organisms for their food. Correct. Vikas, S, correct. Veena, correct. Plants cannot exhibit locomotion, whereas animals exhibit locomotion. Then, reproduction. Usually, in lower organisms, we see asexual or asexual mode of reproduction, whereas in higher organisms, we see sexual mode of reproduction. Then, we have development. So, in the development, there is series of stages of transformation from zygote to an adult. So, that we study and that is seen in animals. So, series of stages is seen in the conversion of zygote, unicellular zygote into a multicellular adult organism. So, these are all some salient features that we see in kingdom Animalia. Understood? Eukaryotic, they have the cell without cell wall. Plastids are absent. Plastids are seen in plants that helps in photosynthesis. Multicellular, due to this multicellular nature, the cells are grouped into tissues, organs and organ system. Heterotrophic, they cannot prepare their own food. Locomotion, they exhibit movement or they can displace from one place to another place. Reproduction, in lower organisms we see asexual mode of reproduction, whereas in higher organisms we see sexual mode of reproduction. Development, we can see the series of stages in the conversion of, in the transformation of embryo to an adult. So, these developmental stages are basis in the classification of organisms. All these features we consider in the classification of organisms. So, your fundamental features that helps in classifying organisms, we have nearly 8 to 10. So, one is grade of organization. Next, we have body wall. Body plan. Coelom. Digestive system, circulatory system, segmentation, notochord, next development. Body temperature, then habitat. So, on the basis of some fundamental features, we are going to classify organisms into different phylums. So, we'll discuss now one by one. So, under grade of organization, we have cellular level, tissue level, organ or organ system level. So we know that animals are multicellular. So here in grades of organization, we have three types: cellular level, tissue level, and organ or organ system level. In cellular level, cells group themselves, but they not do common function. Cell aggregation, we see cells grouped, but they will not do common function. That level is cellular level, seen in phylum Porifera. In 9th hodidira, phylums, different phylums you have read in your 9th standard. See, cellular level alli cells group together, but they will not form tissue. Yavaga tissue agate? When the cells do the group of cells, when they perform a common function, then it becomes tissue. But illenagutte, cells group together, but they'll not do common function. That level is called cellular level organization, seen in phylum Porifera. Tissue level antandre, here the cells group together and they form common function, and they do common function. So in tissue level alenagutte, cells group together and they do common function. That level is called tissue level organization, seen in phylum Coelenterata and phylum Ctenophora. Organ system level or organ system level alli, the tissues group together and form and do common function to form a tissues and sorry tissues group together and they start doing common function to form an organ, and that leads to organ system level organization. So organ level organization we seen in phylum Platyhelminthes and Ascalminthes, and organ system level organization we see from phylum Annelida to or phylum Chordata. So these are three levels of organization. Okay. So next we'll move with body wall. So during embryogenesis, when single cell zygote undergo repeated mitotic division, so that results in the formation of three layers. So that three layers are called germinal layers. That give rise to different organs and organ system in future. During embryogenesis, single cell, that is zygote, undergo repeated mitotic division to increase number of cells. Then the cells arrange themselves to form germinal layers. Usually we have three germinal layers. One is outer ectoderm, middle mesoderm, and inner endoderm. Understood? So three germinal layers yavyado? Outer ectoderm, middle mesoderm, inner endoderm. Okay, based on these germinal layers, so we group organisms into two categories. One is diploblastic, another one is triploblastic. Illa nimige answer sigutte. Diploblastic means here we see two germinal layers. We see two germinal layers. So center cavity is alimentary canal. It is surrounded by endoderm. Then we see in the middle layer, we see undifferentiated layer, that is mesoglia, and outer is so here. Ectoderm, mesenchyme or mesoglia, endoderm. When organisms have only two germinal layers, that is well differentiated germinal layers, ectoderm and endoderm, those organisms come under diploblastic organisms. In between ectoderm and endoderm, middle layer is mesenchyme or mesoglia, that is undifferentiated cells. Undifferentiated cells, antandre, they are not very well developed anta hele. So, if the organisms have two germinal layers, ectoderm and endoderm, in between these two, undifferentiated layer is present, that we call it as mesenchyme. So, those organisms are called diploblastic organisms. Okay. Triploblastic. Examples for diploblastic organisms are phylum Coelenterate and Chenopora. Triploblastic. Illere. Three layers. These organisms will develop from three germinal layers, outer ectoderm, middle mesoderm. We can see well differentiated middle layer, that is mesoderm, and inner endoderm. So, those organisms which develop from all the three germinal layers, that is ectoderm, outer ectoderm, middle mesoderm, and inner endoderm, they are called triploblastic organisms. From phylum Platyhelminthes to phylum Chordata, they come under triploblastic organisms. Understood? So the next is body plan. We have cell aggregate plan. Next, blind sac plan, tube within a tube plan. So, cell aggregate plan. Cell aggregate plan alone agate cells here. Body plan means various parts, arrangement of various parts in an organism is nothing but body plan. So, in this we have cell aggregate plan. Cell aggregate alone agate cells aggregate themselves, but they not do common function seen in phylum Porifera. Blind sac alone agate only one opening is present, like in Planaria. Okay, we see only one opening which serves as both mouth and anus. In the blind sac plan, we see only one opening. Through this only the food enters and also undigested food will remove out of the body. So it is blind sac planule enirutte. We see only one opening that serves as both a mouth and anus. Tube within a tube. Tube within a tube alli outer one wall is present, one tube is present, that is body wall. Outer is body wall. Inner to that body wall we have digestive tract. One more tube is there, that is digestive tract. Adanna naavu tube within a tube plan anta helu. Understood? So tube within a tube alli enagutte, outer body wall is one tube and inner digestive tract is another tube. And important thing is, it is having two openings. One opening serve as mouth and another one is anus. So that's the difference between blind sac and tube within a tube. That's true. So blind sac we see in phylum Platyhelminthes, whereas in tube within a tube we see from phylum Aschelminthes to phylum Chordata. So the next we have coelom. Based on coelom, we have three types: acoelomates. A means absence of coelom. Coelom andre cavity. Then pseudocoelomates and eucoelomates or coelomates. So what is coelom? It's a cavity present between the body wall and alimentary canal. Suppose this is a body wall, this is alimentary canal or digestive tract, this is body wall. So this is a cavity present between the body wall and digestive tract. Between the body wall and digestive tract is nothing but coelom, and it is lined by mesoderm. Which layer is seen in cavity? We see mesodermal layer. So if that cavity is absent, that organisms are called acoelomates. A and the absence of cavity. So illi nam en nortivi andre, we see all the three germinal layers around the alimentary canal, but there is absence of we see all three germinal layers here. This is alimentary canal surrounded by endoderm. Next layer is mesoderm, and the last one is ectoderm. This is ectoderm. So there is no cavity. Understood? So in this we have outer ectoderm, middle mesoderm and inner endoderm. There is no cavity between the body wall and the alimentary canal. Those organisms can come under acoelomates. So example for acoelomate is phylum Platyhelminthes. Pseudocoelomate. Pseudocoelomate alenagutte andre, mesoderm is scattered into pouches. Cavity ಇಲ್ಲಿ ಕಂಪ್ಲೀಟ್ ಆಗಿ ಕ್ಯಾವಿಟಿ ಫಾರ್ಮ್ ಆಗಿರಲ್ಲ, ಬಟ್ ಕ್ಯಾವಿಟಿ ಏನಾಗಿರುತ್ತೆ, ಇಟ್ ಇಸ್ ಸ್ಕ್ಯಾಟರ್ಡ್ ಇನ್ ಟು pouches that is called pseudo means false cavity. See, like this. When cavity is formed in the form of pouches, so mesoderm is scattered into pouches, that is nothing but pseudocoelomate, false cavity seen in phylum Ascelminthes or phylum Nematodes. Then eucoelomate or true coelomates, here we see a definite cavity formed. We see a definite cavity between the body wall and the alimentary canal, which is lined by mesoderm. So your cavity is lined by mesoderm. So that organisms where the cavity is present between the ectoderm, and endoderm, that is between the body wall and alimentary canal, and which is lined by mesodermal layer, are called coelomates or eucoelomates seen from phylum Annelids to phylum Chordata. So that is about cavity. Next, based on circulatory system, so digestive system only, we have protostomes and deuterostomes also. In digestive system, if the mouth forms first from the blastopore, they are called protostomes. If the anus forms first from the blastopore, they are called deuterostomes. That we'll discuss in your regular classes. In circulatory system, it is of two types. Animals are grouped into two types. One is the organisms which show open circulatory system, and another one is closed circulatory system. Open circulatory system alle enagutte andre, like in cockroach, so these chambers of heart, the blood will spill out from the heart to the surrounding cells and tissues. From the heart, the blood will be spilled to the surrounding sinuses or tissues, where cells and tissues are bathed in the blood. Heart in the end agutte blood surrounding tissues and organs ge spill agutte. Now all the organs and tissues are bathed in the blood. That type of circulatory system is called open circulatory system. Seen in phylum Arthropoda and in phylum Mollusca. Whereas closed circulatory system, what we see in human beings, the blood flows through a definite blood vessels like artery, veins and capillaries. From the heart, blood flows through a definite blood vessels like artery, veins and capillaries. That type of system is called closed circulatory system. Phylum Annelid shows closed, it's the first phylum where we see the closed circulatory system. It's based on circulatory system. Now based on notochord, if notochord is present, they are called vertebrates. or chordates. If not a chord is absent, therefore invertebrates or non-chordates. Notochord is derived from mesoderm. Competitive question irunge. Notochord is derived from mesoderm and present dorsally. Dorsally endra idu. Next dorsally endra back. Ventrally means towards the belly. So in this notochord, if organisms possess this notochord, they are called vertebrates. If it is absent, they are called invertebrates. It's this notochord is derived from mesoderm and it is present dorsally. And one more feature is segmentation. If the body is like earthworm, if the body is segment, serial repetition of segmentation, like this, if the body is divided equally both dorsally and ventrally into equal segments, that is nothing but segmentation or metamerism. Seen in phylum Annelida. Next, we have symmetry. Body symmetry. In this, we have asymmetry. Then radial symmetry. Then bilateral symmetry. So, A means what? Absence of symmetry. Symmetry and the when we divide an organism in one plane or any plane, we should get two equal halves. That is nothing but symmetry. A means absence of symmetry, like in amoeba. So if we divide in any plane, we cannot get two exact two equal halves or mirror images similar. That symmetry is nothing but asymmetry. Seen in phylum Porifera. So radial symmetry means when any plane passes through the center axis of an organism, so like this is an that divides organism into two equal halves. Those type of symmetry is called radial symmetry. Bilateral symmetry in human beings, when we divide, that is from mouth to anus, top to bottom, we get two equal halves. We get two equal halves of an organism in one plane, that is from oral-aboral axis, antaratma, mouth to anus, then we get two similar half of an organism. So that type of symmetry is seen in bilateral symmetry. So right and left, dorsal and ventral side, we see in this bilateral symmetry. Understood? So based on symmetry, organisms are grouped under asymmetry. Here we cannot get two equal halves. In radial symmetry, when any plane passes through a center of axis of an organism, we get two equal halves. In bilateral, in one plane, when we cut the organism, we get two equal halves. Yes, because ma'am, radial symmetry can be seen in starfish. Yes. In echinoderms, that's the important feature in andre, larva shows bilateral symmetry, whereas adult shows radial symmetry. Starfish shows radial symmetry. Understood? Then pitkoli, in phylum Echinodermata, larva shows bilateral symmetry and adult echinoderms shows radial symmetry. So, bilateral symmetry example is human beings. Then based on development, ನಾವು ಡೈರೆಕ್ಟ್ ಡೆವಲಪ್ಮೆಂಟ್ ಇಂಡೈರೆಕ್ಟ್ ಡೆವಲಪ್ಮೆಂಟ್ ಅಂತ ಹೇಳ್ತೀವಿ ಸೊ ವಾಟ್ಸ್ ದ ಡಿಫ್ರೆನ್ಸ್ ಬಿಟ್ವೀನ್ ಡೈರೆಕ್ಟ್ ಅಂಡ್ ಇಂಡೈರೆಕ್ಟ್ ಡೆವಲಪ್ಮೆಂಟ್ ಡೈರೆಕ್ಟ್ ಡೆವಲಪ್ಮೆಂಟ್ ಅಂದ್ರೆ ವೆನ್ ದ ಆಫ್ ಸ್ಪ್ರಿಂಗ್ ರಿಸೆಂಬಲ್ಸ್ ದೇರ್ ಪೇರೆಂಟ್ ದಟ್ ಟೈಪ್ ಆಫ್ ಡೆವಲಪ್ಮೆಂಟ್ ಇಸ್ ಕಾಲ್ಡ್ ಡೈರೆಕ್ಟ್ ಡೆವಲಪ್ಮೆಂಟ್ ಲೈಕ್ ಹ್ಯೂಮನ್ ಬೀಯಿಂಗ್ ಇಂಡೈರೆಕ್ಟ್ ಡೆವಲಪ್ಮೆಂಟ್ ಮೀನ್ಸ್ ವೆನ್ ಆಫ್ ಸ್ಪ್ರಿಂಗ್ಸ್ ವಿಲ್ ನಾಟ್ ರಿಸೆಂಬಲ್ ದೇರ್ ಪೇರೆಂಟ್ ಲೈಕ್ ಇನ್ ಫ್ರಾಗ್ ಫ್ರಾಗ್ ಅಲ್ಲಿ ನೋಡಿ ಟ್ಯಾಡ್ಪೋಲ್ಸ್ ಆಫ್ಟರ್ ದ ಮೆಟಮಾರ್ಫೋಸಿಸ್ ದೇ ಬಿಕಮ್ ಅಡಲ್ಟ್ ಫ್ರಾಗ್ ಸೊ ಆ ತರ ಡೆವಲಪ್ಮೆಂಟ್ ಗೆ ನಾವೇನ್ ಹೇಳ್ತೀವಿ ಇನ್ಡೈರೆಕ್ಟ್ ಡೆವಲಪ್ಮೆಂಟ್ ಅನಿಸ್ಟ್ ಸೊ ಡೈರೆಕ್ಟ್ ಡೆವಲಪ್ಮೆಂಟ್ ಅಲ್ಲಿ ಆಫ್ ಸ್ಪ್ರಿಂಗ್ಸ್ ಆರ್ ನ್ಯೂ ಬಾರ್ನ್ ರಿಸೆಂಬಲ್ ಆಸ್ ಸೂನ್ ಆಸ್ ದೇ ಬಾರ್ನ್ ದೇ ರಿಸೆಂಬಲ್ ದೇ ಪೇರೆಂಟ್ ವೆರಸ್ ಇನ್ ಇನ್ಡೈರೆಕ್ಟ್ ಡೆವಲಪ್ಮೆಂಟ್ ದೇ ಅಂಡರ್ಗೋ ಮೆಟಮಾರ್ಫೋಸಿಸ್ ಟು ಅಟೈನ್ ದೇ ಪೇರೆಂಟಲ್ features that is seen in indirect development understood so indirect development is seen in like class amphibians that is frog and not TV direct development we see in human class mammalia and based on habitat we can classify them as terrestrial aquatic and aerial understood ನಿಮಗೆ ಗೊತ್ತಿದೆ ಟೆರೆಸ್ಟ್ರಿಯಲ್ ಮೀನ್ಸ್ ದೇ ಆರ್ ಏಬಲ್ ಟು ದೇ ಆರ್ ದೋಸ್ ಆರ್ಗಾನಿಸಮ್ಸ್ ವಿಚ್ ಲೀವ್ ಆನ್ ಲ್ಯಾಂಡ್ ಆರ್ ಕಾಲ್ ಟೆರೆಸ್ಟ್ರಿಯಲ್ ಆರ್ಗಾನಿಸಮ್ಸ್ ಅಕ್ವಾಟಿಕ್ ವಿಚ್ ಲೀವ್ ಇನ್ ವಾಟರ್ ಏರಿಯಲ್ ಮೀನ್ಸ್ ದೇ ಕ್ಯಾನ್ ಫ್ಲೈ ಇನ್ ಏರ್ ಸೊ ದಟ್ ಈಸ್ ಬೇಸ್ಡ್ ಆನ್ ದೇರ್ ಹ್ಯಾಬಿಟ್ಯಾಟ್ ಅಂಡ್ ಅಗೇನ್ ಬೇಸ್ಡ್ ಆನ್ ದೇರ್ ಬಾಡಿ ಟೆಂಪರೇಚ್ ವಿ ಹ್ಯಾವ್ ಪಾಯ್ಕಿಲೋಥರ್ಮ್ಸ್ ಅಂಡ್ ಹೋಮಿಯೋಥರ್ಮ್ಸ್ ಇನ್ ಪಾಯ್ಕಿಲೋಥರ್ಮ್ಸ್ ಲೈಕ್ ಫಿಶಸ್ ದೇ ಕೆನಾಟ್ ಅಡ್ಜಸ್ಟ್ ದೇರ್ ಬಾಡಿ ಟೆಂಪರೇಚರ್ That's why they adjust body temperature to the external environmental temperature. So they are called poikilotherms or cold-blooded organisms. Homeotherms like human beings, we are able to maintain homeostasis. We are able to maintain constant internal body temperature irrespective to any changes that occurs in environment. So those organisms are called homeotherms. So example human beings so like this based on some fundamental characters organisms are grouped they are classified into different phylums we'll discuss them now so classification of animal kingdom See here, usually animal kingdom This animal kingdom is classified into Protozoa and Metazoa. Protozoa means protoplasmic level. Metazoa means multicellular level. Or here we see protoplasmic level or cell acellular level. Okay? Or cell group agalanta. Multicellular or metazoa again classified into parazoa and eumetazoa. So under parazoa we have only one phylum that is phylum porifera or sponges and eumetazoa From phylum coelenterates to phylum chordata, they come under eumetazoa. That means true animals. Why they are called true animals? And they show evolution. So tissues group to form organs, then organ system, and then organism. So that's why from phylum coelenterate to phylum chordata, they come under eumetazoa. ಸೊ ಇಲ್ಲಿ ಫೈಲಮ್ ಪೊರಿಫೆರಾನ ನಾವು ಸಬ್ ಫೈಲಮ್ ಪಾರಾಜೋವಾದಲ್ಲಿ ಹೋಗ್ತೀವಿ ಯಾಕೆಂದ್ರೆ ಇಟ್ ವಿಲ್ ನಾಟ್ ಶೋ ದ ಎವಲ್ಯೂಷನ್ ಇಯರ್ ಸೆಲ್ಫ್ ಗ್ರೂಪ್ ಟುಗೆದರ್ but they'll not do common function. Hagagi, this phylum Porifera is come under Parasova, whereas the organisms which shows evolution, they come under Eumetasova. Understood? So we'll discuss now the classification of animal kingdom. So here, see, animal kingdom multicellular are classified based on levels of organization. Cellular level, example, porifera. Tissue or organ or organ system level, again they are divided into based on symmetry, radial and bilateral symmetry. Radially, we have examples, phylum Coelenterata, they are also called Cnidaria, and phylum Ctenophora. And a bilateral, again divided based on the coelom, presence of body cavity. Without body cavity, they are called acoelomates. Example, phylum Platyhelminthes. With false coelom, example, Aschelminthes. And with two coelom, the phylum Annelida to phylum Chordata come under coelomates. Next, phylum Porifera. We know that this phylum shows cellular level of organization. Specialized cells seen in this phylum is choanocytes. They are also called collar cells, and they show water canal system. So every explanation we'll discuss in your regular classes. Examples, Typha Euplectella. Ili new diagram notta idira, image notta idiralla, adu Euplectella, adana Venus flower basket anta heltivi. Japan alli idana avaru gift ಹಾಗೆ ಯೂಸ್ ಬೇರೆಯವರಿಗೆ ಗಿಫ್ಟ್ ಕೊಡಕ್ಕೆ ಯೂಸ್ ಮಾಡ್ತಾರೆ. ಸಿ ದ ಅರೇಂಜ್ಮೆಂಟ್ ಆಫ್ ಸಿಲಿಕಾ, ಅಲ್ಲಿ ಯುಪ್ಲೆಕ್ಟಲದಲ್ಲಿ ಸಿಲಿಕಾ ಅರೇಂಜ್ಮೆಂಟ್ ನೋಡಿ. ಇಟ್ಸ್ ಅ ವೆರಿ ಇಂಟ್ರೆಸ್ಟಿಂಗ್ ಫೈಲಮ್ ದಿಸ್ ಇಸ್. ಸೊ ದಟ್ ಇಸ್ ಫೈಲಮ್ ಪೋರಿಫೆರಾ, ವಿ ಶೋ ಸೆಲ್ಯುಲರ್ ಲೆವೆಲ್ ಆರ್ಗನೈಸೇಷನ್. ನೆಕ್ಸ್ಟ್ ಫೈಲಮ್ ಸಿಲೆಂಟರೇಟಾ ಆರ್ ನೈಡೇರಿಯಾ. ಸೊ ದಿಸ್ ದ ಫಸ್ಟ್ ಫೈಲಮ್ ವೇರ್ ವಿ ಸಿ ಟಿಶ್ಯೂ ಗ್ರೇಡ್ ಆಫ್ ಆರ್ಗನೈಸೇಷನ್. All the four tissues, epithelial tissue, connective tissue, muscular tissue and nervous tissue are formed in primitive, they are present in primitive form. So that, this is the first phylum where we see tissue grade of organization. So in this, neuroblast are specialized cells and it shows gastrovascular cavity or coelenteron. Illi nimge sessile and free living ida. So Hydra is sessile. Sessile means they'll adhere to the substratum. They'll not move from one place to another. Whereas Obelia and Aurelia ida nodi. Obelia the feature in antandre, Obelia shows both sessile nature and free living nature. That means it shows metagenesis. It can convert from polyp to medusa. Polyp is a sessile form of coelenterate. Medusa is a free living form of coelenterates. Ili Aurelia, jellyfish, it shows free living. So Hydra is sessile, Aurelia is jellyfish. Obelia is shows both the characteristics of sessile and free living, that is polyp and medusa. So it is about phylum coelenterate. Phylum Ctenophora, this shows tissue grade of organization. Coloblasts are special adhesive cells. And very important property or very important feature of this phylum is bioluminescent property. Bio means living. When living organisms emit light, that is considered as bioluminescence. So, alodi, ratri avuttu light emit agodhu easier kanutte. So, example, Pleurobrachia. That's why these ctenophores are also called sea gooseberries or sea ghosts. Next, phylum Platyhelminthes. This shows organ system level organization. And flame cells or solenocytes are specialized cells. They are excretory cells. Excretory cells and they help to remove metabolic waste from a body and also helps to maintain thermoregulation. And acoelomates, there are no cavity between body wall and alimentary canal. And planaria shows regenerative capacity. So example, they are given planaria, schizostoma, fasciola, understood. Next, phylum, Aschelminthes or Nematihelminthes or nematodes. New ninthalin, sulpa or didira phylums. We'll discuss in detail in few points I have taken in this class, but in your regular classes, we'll discuss each point in detail. So this phylum shows organ system level organization, pseudocoelomates. That means mesoderm is scattered into pouches. And it's the first phylum where we see sexual dimorphism. And then male is separate and female is separate. Ascaris is in the roundworm. Common name is roundworm. Today, male is thicker, length is more. Sorry, female is thick and length is more. Whereas in male roundworm, anal end is curved. It's the main key feature which helps us to differentiate male roundworm and female roundworm. Male roundworm alenagate, it is length is less thin when compared to female, and anal end is curved. Eradu male and female alli clear agi differentiate maadabodu. Male alli anal end enagide curve agide. So understood. And this is the first phylum where we see sexual dimorphism. Male is separate, female is separate. Next, phylum Annelida. This shows organ system level organization. And this is the first phylum where we see closed type of circulatory system. Nephridia are special excretory cells. And it's the first phylum where we see true cavity between the body wall and alimentary canal. That coelomates, example, aquatic Annelidis neris, leech, himikotide, earthworms. Coming to phylum Arthropoda. So it's the largest phylum in the animal kingdom, shows organ system level organization and exoskeleton, chitinous exoskeleton. Body is divided into head, thorax and abdomen. It shows open type of circulatory system and there are also coelomates. Examples, you know that spider, scorpion, all insects belongs to phylum Arthropoda. Coming to mollusca, it's the second largest kingdom in animal kingdom. That also shows organ system level organization. There are coelomates. And important feature is calcareous shell is present. It may be present externally or internally. And we see octopus is a very good example for phylum mollusca. And phylum Echinodermata. So new kelidira, because ma'am, radial symmetry can be seen in starfish and tahili. Yes, in phylum Echinodermata, starfish belongs to phylum Echinodermata. Adhil innan deyanandra, larva of Echinodermata shows bilateral symmetry, whereas adult Echinoderm shows radial symmetry. So organ system level organization, and it is the first phylum where we see endoskeleton and water vascular system or ambolacral system is present. Example, estrias, that is starfish, and echinus. Phylum Hemichordata, here it also shows organ system level organization, open circulatory system, and there are also coelomates. Idu Hemichordata anta heltivi andre stomachord, which is homologous to notochord, is present in this phylum Hagagi, but as it shows open circulatory system, this phylum is not classified under phylum Chordata, because in under phylum Chordata they show closed type of circulatory system. That's why it's the last phylum under phylum invertebrates. Example, Balanoclosis. Then phylum called it, again divided into three subphylum, vertebrata, cephalochordata and urochordata. Phylum chordata, salient features of phylum chordata are, they should possess dorsal hollow now cord, pharyngeal gill slits, then post anal tail is present. So some features, fundamental features should be present in organisms, those that like presence of notochord, pharyngeal nerve, then nerve cord, presence of nerve cord, then pharyngeal gill slits, post anal tail. So based on that, we group organisms in phylum chordata. It is divided into three subphylum, phylum vertebrata, cephalochordata and urochordata. In subphylum vertebrata, notochord is replaced by either cartilage or bone when they reach adult stage. Whereas in subphylum cephalochordata, notochord is present from 82 tail region and persists throughout their life. Whereas in subphylum urochordata, notochord is seen only in the larva stage, that too in tail region. So in this, this is the difference between three subphylums, vertebrata, cephalochordata and urochordata. So again, subphylum vertebrata is divided into two divisions, agnatha and gnathostomata. Agnatha and the absence of jaws. So jaws say illa namginodi, maxillary jaw and mandibular is there. So that helps in chewing the food or masticating food. Agnatha lacks jaws say illa andaginagate, they have circular mouth, they suck the food. Understood? So agnatha and gnatha. And our agnatha, one class is there, that is class cyclostomata. Gnathostomata, they have jaws, maxillary and mandibular jaws. Again, that is divided into two superclasses, Pisces and Tetrapoda. Under Pisces, we have Chondrichthyes and Osteoctes. Whereas Tetrapoda, we have class Amphibia, Reptilia, Aves and Mammals. This cartilaginous fish, ilenagate, the endoskeleton is made up of cartilage, whereas in bony fishes, the endoskeleton is made up of bone. In class Amphibia, we know that they are terrestrial organisms, but they need water for their reproduction, like frog. And class Reptilia, here they are cold-blooded organisms, oviparous in nature. And in class Aves, four limbs are modified into wings. They have pneumatic bones that helps them for flying. And in class Mammals, we see air on their body and external ear pinna is present. The teeth are heterodont. Heterodont, right? Two sets. Sorry, heterodont means different types of teeth. Neo odidira tenthali, incisors, canines, premolars and molars. It are different types of teeth that is called heterodont. Diphyodont means two sets of teeth. One do permanent teeth, inondo milk teeth. And thecodont and the teeth are present in a bony socket. They are called thecodont, that is seen in class Mammals under viviparous. So except platypus. So this is about different phylums. So we'll discuss in detail about all the phylums in your regular classes. So this slide shows you that if you opt biology in your PUC, you can go for medical and paramedical science courses, like medical courses like MBBS, Bachelor of Medicine and Surgery, BDS, Bachelor of Dental Science, BAMS, Bachelor of Ayurvedic Medicine and Surgery. Like that, you have BHMS, Veterinary Sciences, Animal Husbandry and Physiotherapy. So paramedical sciences, you have nuclear medicine technology. Here the person is trained to use radioactive traces to diagnose diseases and to treat diseases. respiratory therapy technology, here the person is trained. S Vikas 2102 is incisors, 1 is canine, 0 means absence of premolars, and 2 are presence of 2 molars seen in S Vikas, that is seen in milk teeth, 2123 by 2123 in permanent teeth. Very good, Vikas. So premolars are not seen in milk teeth, whereas premolars are seen in permanent teeth, and last third molar is not seen in milk teeth, that is seen in permanent teeth. That's why dental formula is 2102 by 2102 in milk teeth and 2123 by 2123 permanent teeth. So respiratory therapy technology, the person is trained to treat critical patients, those who are suffering from severe cardiac and pulmonary diseases and lung diseases. Audiology and speech therapy, a person is trained for different speech and also hearing disorders. Prosthesis and orthotics. Orthotics are devices that enhances the efficiency of that organ. Prosthesis andre ivakka ee kaalu accident aagi cut aadre adanna replace madodu prosthesis. Like this you have many courses after your PUC if you opt biology in PUC semester. So thank you children, thank you. In the next class we'll discuss plant tissues and anatomy of flowering plants. Thank you very much.